Some say we're on the verge of a great awakening. Others claim the powerful Puppetmaster's multifaceted stranglehold is stronger than ever. And on the Higher Side Chats, we explore the conspiracies, the mysterious, the alternative, and the occult, on a quest that rests firmly on the fringe, which won't be sponsored by Audible or Stamps.com, nor picked up by the gatekeepers of conventional media or radio. It's a quest of the people. So if you enjoyed this first free hour of THC, consider sponsoring the journey yourself by subscribing at thehiresidechatsplus.com. Just $5 a month gets you a second hour with all our great guests on each of our month's five shows. You can also make your own topic and guest suggestions right on your THC Plus profile, communicate with Greg Carlwood, and have your own custom RSS feed URL to use and still listen on the majority of popular podcast applications. You can also support the show with a donation into the THC Money Bomb, where on the last show of every month, we give half of the total donations back to one of the random listeners like you who could use a nice surprise in these troubled times. And lastly, to support THC in a free and equally important way, share the show with your friends, review us where you can, and join us in the conversation on Facebook, Twitter, and our subreddit forum, where THC fans and the cerebral adventurers of the counterculture have taken refuge and discuss the finer points of our never-ending struggle to tip the scales in favor of truth, peace, and enlightenment in a war-torn, corrupt, and shady world. Let the games begin.
Hey Greg, this is Asa, this month's Money Bomb winner and a proud member of the Higher Side Chat. I am so excited about finding you, and I'm about a month into listening to your show, and I love every minute of it. I have to tell you, this money comes at a much-needed time, and when I think about it, I guess most of the money I will use as far as building my business, getting some software, things like that, paying a couple of bills, and I definitely want to buy a couple of your teas. Give some back to the Higher Side. My three favorite guests that you've had on so far is David Matheson, Marty Lees, which I absolutely love. It just opened up a whole new world for me. Robert Phoenix, because I am also an astrologer, so I was definitely feeling him. And I have to mention, I also like Dave Asprey. When he was on your show, I learned a whole lot. Well, Greg, thank you, and thank you for all you do. Keep up the good work, and I will be there with the Higher Side Chat people, puffing all with you. Peace and blessings, and thanks again.
In the 1930s, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt addressed the nation through a series of radio broadcasts known as the Fireside Chats. His aim was to reassure the common man that our society would recover from its troubled times. But we're far from 1930, and I deal with a different kind of far. For a new era of worldly frustration, we offer a fresh conversation. I'm Greg Carlwood, and these are the Higher Side Chats.
How's it going, Higher Side Chatters from San Diego? I'm Greg Carlwood, drinking a little drink, smoking a lot of smoke, just like many of the assassination victims we're going to talk about today, and this is an interesting show for sure. Today's guest has identified a group called Operation 40 and can link them by association or method to many, many false flag events, foreign coups, political assassinations, but also several big rock star assassinations. So this show is largely about Operation 40 and the people and crimes involved, but I really wanted to focus in on these rock star killings. So in the first hour, after a lengthy introduction to these guys, we get into Jimi Hendrix and John Lennon's deaths. And then in the second hour, we talk about Bob Marley and Whitney Houston, mainly just because I wanted to map out this group's crimes against humanity chronologically. And that's just the way the cookie crumbles. So congrats to the new Money Bomb winner as well. I hope I never stop giving back to the listeners. It's something that I think separates us from nearly every other show out there. So congrats to her. I'm happy she could win. And I hope all you guys still like that part of the program. And with that said, let's just dive into the dark and dangerous world of Operation 40 with today's guest, Ole Dammegard.
The Higher Side Chat. To UFO, sure to grab your weed.
All right, people, we've been around long enough to notice the inconsistencies and coincidences surrounding the deaths of some of culture's most influential figures, whether it be revolutionaries like Martin Luther King Jr. or Malcolm X, or political rebels like JFK or Princess Diana, and even some of the most iconic names in music history like John Lennon, Jimi Hendrix, or Bob Marley. All of these folks died premature deaths in relatively unusual ways, and it makes one wonder if there might be a branch on the tree of global enslavement aimed at doing these dirty deeds when the order comes down from on high. And lucky for us, today's guest has spent 30 years examining just such a branch. His name is Ole Dammegard, the man behind LightOnConspiracies.com. He's an award-winning author, inventor, former journalist, and investigator who has dedicated himself to mapping out this network of assassins and getting the names involved with these high-profile deaths, as well as many of the false flag events we've seen over the years, much of which can be found in his book, Coup d'etat in Slow Motion. It's a fascinating thread of connections, and I can't wait to get down to it. Ole, my man, welcome to THC.
Thank you so much, Greg. It's an absolute honor.
Well, thank you, man. I'm really happy that you reached out to me. I've heard you on every conspiratorial radio program under the sun, and it's a real honor to add the Higher Side Chats to your list of credentials. I've speculated for a long time that elements of these deaths fit a certain pattern and probably involved a lot of the same players, but I haven't seen anyone who's mapped out these people and the connections between these ritualistic murders like you have. So this is pretty important work, and I guess the best place to start us off would be as close to the beginning as we can get. And this group of assassins seems to carry out their activities under the name Operation 40, right? So can you tell us about how this group was put together?
I can indeed. I tell you, like you said, I spent 30 years looking into this, even more than 30 years, and I thought that all of these different events was totally separate. I had no idea that they were connected in any way or form, and it's just over the years, the deeper I've been digging into them, that I ended up with the leads taking me the exact same route and tracking me back down to the same small elite group. The group I'm talking about is the group that is now behind the so-called New World Order. But not only have I found that it is this so-called power elite, I prefer calling them minority because there's so few actually, mm-hmm. even though they're trying to scare us into believing that they're so extremely powerful. I would say we're the ones that are powerful, at least, and we're outnumbering them in the millions, you know, billions. But not only is it the same group that are behind so many of these atrocities, I mean, we're talking high-level assassinations, terror acts, all types of different wars, civil wars, you name it, so much mayhem in the world. Not only is it the same group that are given the orders from way up in the near the top of the pyramid, power pyramid, but also what I found out is that they've actually used the same type of assassins, not only the same type of assassins, but actually the same assassins for decades, really decades. And this has been a mind-blowing experience for me to find out this thing. And just like you said, the group that I have exposed or I'm focusing on exposing big time is a group called Operation 40 or Group 40. Now, if I take you back in to the late 1950s and very early 1960s, the president at that time was Dwight Eisenhower, and they were in a situation where they thought that it would be good to put together a team of problem solvers, as they sometimes call them, a team of assassins that could be sent globally to get rid of whoever they wanted, you know, because here we're not talking only so-called politics, but it's big business. And we're talking, you know, the big military industrial complex, major companies like United Fruit, Standard Oil, Pepsi Cola, Coca-Cola, these type of companies that were behind that and that was trying to invade the rest of the world, you know, just rape and plunder. And they needed a violent tool to be able to use when they had problems in Latin America or in the States or in Europe, wherever. So the order didn't really come from Dwight Eisenhower, but he accepted that this was being carried out. And the task was given to his vice president, a man by the name of Richard Nixon. at that time, Nixon's career was going downhill quite a lot. He was not very famous at the time, but he was given the task to put this team together. And what he did was he used a veteran team, or a team of hardened veterans from the coup in Guatemala 1954, when they took out the dictator, or the president there. And he used these people, and the people he used from the CIA was E. Howard Hunt, who was later very famous as one of the Watergate burglars. You will see here that all the people involved in the Watergate burglary were from Operation 40. He's also famous for his part in the JFK assassination. And if you want to, later we can go into great details about the JFK assassination, where I can point out a major part of the shooters involved came directly from Operation 40. Another man was Ted the Blonde Ghost Shackley, who was an incredible, skilled, and very, very cold, hard CIA operative who made his way all the way up to the top of the CIA, being the chief of the covert operation for the Western Hemisphere. The man that he took over the job from was also part of Operation 40. This was way down the line in the 70s when he took over after him. But the man that he worked side by side with, his name was David Atlee Phillips. He was also known under Harold Benson or Maurice Bishop, these two identities. This was a man, an incredible expert on propaganda, and he has been behind so much of this brainwashing propaganda, how to trick population into believing a lot of these false flag operations and so on. And David Atlee Phillips was actually not only, he was the station chief in Mexico City at that time, but he was also the CIA controller of no one less than Lee Harvey Oswald, the patsy for the JFK assassination, the one that had to take the fall for it, that was actually totally innocent. What he was trying to was actually to reveal that the assassination was going down, and he was trying to save the JFK. So I actually see him historically as a hero, absolutely not this hoodlum that he's been painted out as.
Interesting.
But David Atlee Phillips was also the controller for James Files, who was the shooter behind the picket fence and who was the one that fired the final headshot. According to me, I've studied this guy for years. He's still alive. And I've only found one little lie that he told over the years. He's incredible in his detail. And I totally believe this guy's word, even though some researchers thinks he's lying. So David Atlee Phillips, not only the controller for the patsy, but also for one of the shooters, and deeply, deeply involved in the JFK assassination. And many, many, many. Like I say, he later became the head of the CIA for the Western Hemisphere for covert operations. I mean, this is a major player. So we got these people, and what they did was they sent these people down to Florida, mostly, to recruit. Most of the people they recruited were exiled Cubans who had just escaped from Cuba, where Fidel Castro had taken over. And many of these people were former police men, Batista regime. They were from force. Some of them were high up politicians. Many of them brutal, very brutal people, mercenaries and soldiers and so on. So they were recruited in Miami into this very, very secret group called Operation 40. There was one woman, Marita Lorenz, who was a former lover of Fidel Castro, and they recruited her as what they wanted was for her to assassinate Fidel Castro. But she never did, apparently. She had doesn't matter, she had a child with another dictator and so on. She is also still around. But in this group, Operation 40, it is unreal once you start studying who the members of this group is. There's more and more information coming out. I've done everything I can to dig up as much as possible. But the connections and what these people have been up to, because they have been extremely busy since the early 1960s, and some of them all the way up until today. They're some of them are white-haired old guys now, but still active, I tell you. And Operation 40 has been called the grandmother of operations. It was almost like they were the ones that pulled off the big one with JFK. And after that, they have been very central in many, many, many hits and false flags, but also in educating other assassins and so on. So when you study this group, you will see that, for instance, there's one man called David Morales. He was in Dealey Plaza. He was one of the guys driving the escape cars. He was the one that picked up the three people from the top floor where Lee Harvey Oswald is said to have been. There's multiple shooters, so I'm just pointing out a few points.
Mm-hmm.
But they ran out on the behind the Texas School Book Depository. He picked them up in Ruth Payne's car and drove off. But he was also at the Ambassador Hotel in 68 when Robert Kennedy was assassinated together with two other CIA operatives. Just surveying or being in control of the whole situation. So he was both in Dallas and in Los Angeles when Robert was killed.
Wow.
He was also the guy that killed Che Guevara. He was together with Felix Rodriguez, who was another one from Operation 40, and who is super central in the whole Iran-Contra scandal, and who has followed George Bush Sr. Side by side through his whole career as one of the problem solvers, taking people out and getting rid of whatever problem appeared.
Man.
And they went, Henry Kissinger, which is one of the major players here, is also when it comes to the CIA operation and so on. They were sent down to Bolivia to track this guy down, and they used some local soldiers, and then it was Felix Rodriguez and David Morales. They tracked him down, they caught him, and Felix was the one that gave the order to execute him, but the guy that actually shot him was Che Guevara. No, sorry, it was David Morales.
Who shot Che Guevara.
Yeah, and Felix Rodriguez to this very day is walking around with Che Guevara's wristwatch. Very proud of that one.
Oh, wow. Talk about insult to injury.
Well, they're proud of what they're doing, you know. They see themselves, I don't know. I've spoken to friends of these people and ask, how do these people see themselves? Because when you look at it, I would call them terrorists, you know, because these
right.
are cold-blooded murderers and doing terror acts against normal people. But the people I've spoken to, they say that they it's almost like gunslingers in the old West, you know. They live by the gun, they die by the gun, and they're proud of it, you know, even
wow.
though I think some of them must be very, very scared because they are in deep shark waters, you know, surrounded by very violent people.
Right, but it's a fascinating thread of research. I mean, I've been very impressed with the whole story and all the names involved, but I would love to hope that they're scared, but I think they feel like they're so above the law that nothing can happen to them. I mean, there's also three generations of the Bush family involved in this operation as well, correct?
This is the unreal thing, you know, because the paymaster that was appointed to take care of funding this group, he was the one that funneled the funds from the military industrial complex, from oil tycoons, from these big major corporations and so on, and from the mob as well, was pumping money into this, because the CIA and the mob are two sides of the same coin, I would say, with the FBI as well. It's so, you know, it's so infiltrated, so there's no real difference, you know, depending on what is needed to be done. The CIA uses the mob within the borders, the US borders. As soon as they go abroad, they use their own people. And when they do these terror acts and false flag operations, every single time it's the FBI who's training, funding, equipping these different teams that are carrying it out. So, you know, the so-called good guys, I would put a very big question mark to. And, you know, this is the scary thing. The people that are there to protect you are the ones we have to fear, you know. So it's I have people who was murdered in Sweden around me because we were investigating the assassination of the Swedish prime minister, and these two people were not sensitive for that we, when you dig into these things, you are actually like in a minefield. You know, you have to step carefully, and unfortunately, it's only after you stepped on a bomb or a mine that you actually understand it, that it happens.
Right.
And these people were not, they were getting too big-headed, and they kept approaching the official investigation, and we will come to that later, but the official investigation in these major political hits are part of the crime. It's their own people, their own investigation that are on standby, so as soon as the shots are fired, boom, in moves their investigation, so that they can 100% control the whole thing and make absolute sure that nothing of the real truth will come forward.
Right.
You know, so these are the people you have to be aware of and to, you know, to keep your distance from. And my friends, unfortunately, just kept pushing, and they ended up dead, both of them. So, and I left the country just after that because I felt it's getting too close.
Yeah, I'm sorry to hear that, man. That's super sad. But I commend their bravery and yours. I mean, yeah, you're right. You just don't know how much revealing is too much until it's too late.
Do you know, I'm just an ordinary guy. I mean, it's not my job to do these things. It's not, I'm not being paid by anyone. You know, I don't even really know what I'm doing it, except for that I have a major problem when I see people bullying others or people being harassed or beaten up or killed, you know.
Of course.
And when they also, when I see when somebody's trying to rape the world, I mean, it is on that level at the moment. It's just we need to do something, you know, even if it might be with a high price. I mean, so many beautiful people have died. We're going to talk a lot about some of them, beautiful, beautiful, brave people. And for some, this is the price you have to pay. And I have accepted that, even though I really prefer to stay here. Mm-hmm. But I know that this is a risk. And at the same time, somebody needs to do it, you know, because otherwise it's in the silence that these people thrive. It's in the darkness that these people thrive. It's in the conspiracy, in the behind the scenes, the hidden hand behind the scenes, that's where they can keep pulling these things off. And so my website is lightonconspiracies.com, and it's a very handpicked name because what I try to do is aim the spotlight right on them, you know, exposing, put the light on, show what is going on, totally non-violent, but fearlessly just exposing it so that it will stop. You know,
right.
Because as soon as we see how they pull these things off, the more people that awake to the fact how they pull these false flag operations and political assassination, how they do it, once it's done, once you see it, they can't pull it off anymore. You know, so this is my focus.
Yeah, you're right. It seems like to anyone who's really paying attention, the same patterns repeat. You mentioned earlier that they come right in with their own official investigations, which are always bullshit, and yet we let that happen time and time again. The other thing that they constantly do is when they have one of these Operation 40 highly skilled assassins take someone out, there's almost always a drugged up, spaced out guy there as a patsy who doesn't even really know what happened. It was interesting to hear that even the shooter who tried to assassinate Ronald Reagan, or, you know, he was a patsy there and he had dinner with one of the Bush sons right before the shooting. I mean, it's so crazy. You don't have to go that deep to find these really close connections to the people you had mentioned and the Bush family. They're really at the helm of a lot of this stuff.
I tell you, so often these things are no-brainers, and why people don't see it, I have no idea. I mean, sometimes I just feel, how asleep can you be? You know, it's incredible the level of insomnia, that's not the real word, but like how unconscious we have been.
Right.
I look at myself as well, because, you know, many of these things, if you take Robert Kennedy, the assassination, Sirhan had a revolver, 22, with 8 bullets in it. Somewhere around 12 or 13 bullets were fired. Do you have to be very clever to see 8, 12, 13, he didn't have a chance to reload. There must have been a second shooter, okay? You look at, he was standing right in front of Robert Kennedy when he started firing, okay? He started, as soon as he started firing, they jumped him and they grabbed his gun and they put him down on a steam table and got the gun away from him. Okay, you look at the number of people wounded. There were lots of people wounded around him. And Robert Kennedy, of course, since Sirhan was always right in front of Robert Kennedy, of course, all three shots that hit Robert Kennedy must have come straight from the front. Absolutely not. He was hit three times, actually four. The fourth didn't hit him, but the three shots hit him straight from the back and to the right. And the last bullet was fired point blank, touching his skull, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So the big question is, how could Sirhan go and shoot from behind and to the right? He could not.
Right.
So you don't have to be very intelligent to understand the shooter must have been behind him and to the right, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But still to this day, no, it's Sirhan. And this poor guy who's absolutely innocent, he was an MK Ultra victim, you know, a really nice Palestinian guy, absolutely great guy, you know, and he spent almost his whole life, you know, in prison. He's still in prison to this very day, rotting away because of something he had nothing to do with.
Yeah.
It's a shame. And all of us who are asleep are allowing these things to happen, you know. We should be ashamed that we allow innocent people to be stuffed away in you know, and being blamed for things like this.
Well,
and in the center of so much of this is the Bush family.
Mm-hmm.
Incredibly, the level of criminality around that family, unreal.
It is. And it's amazing that they don't get caught. I mean, I guess they are just above the law, because even when they do get caught, at least in the years where the Bushes have been presidents, there have been a couple of times I learned about from you where they have just pardoned the guys in the crew who have gotten caught. So there have been times where these guys go to jail and then Bush, the father or the son as president, is just like, oh, you know, bring them out of jail. Like, I mean, the boldness, the audacity to put yourself in the public eye and so connected, so closely related to these people and just have no fear of prosecution. I mean, that little bit of the puzzle, the fact that they just pardon these people outright, really is probably the most frustrating part, because you think you got them caught and then nope.
But what does that say about us?
You well, know? Yeah.
What does it say about us? Why do they treat us without respect? Because we don't really deserve it, do we? I mean, because they have been getting away with murder, literally. I mean, we're talking mass murder in the form of all of these unjust wars that they have pulled off.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you look at it, when JFK was assassinated, November 22, that was when it all began. Look back, all of these different awful, awful things, the Vietnam War, Operation Condor, all of these overtakes in Latin America, where they killed thousands and thousands of people in Bolivia, in Chile with Operation Condor. All of these assassinations globally, many, many wars, civil wars that they have created as well. And if they haven't been able to do it with military force, then they've sent in their tools, which are, now I'm talking about the global elite, not the Bush family, but the UN, the NATO, the World Bank, the IMF, and so on. If they couldn't hit them military-wise, they'd send in the World Bank or the International Monetary Fund. Very often they go hand in hand, and they go in and they just crush country by country by giving them loans that will just totally wipe them out,
yeah.
not being aware of it, or giving them all of these loans, you know, okay, dear Somalia, now please, you know, focus on cotton. We will give you all of these grants and loans and whatever if you totally focus on cotton. So the whole country goes start growing cotton. Then after 4 or 5 years, they suddenly say, no, sorry, we're going to buy it from Gambia or somewhere.
Right.
And the whole country, they've done this in so many countries. The whole financial situation in that country is just wiped out overnight because suddenly they can't sell cotton, you know, and at the same time, they have all of these loans that they will never be able to repay.
Mm-hmm.
And they've done it on countless countries. So that's just one of the ways. They have many different tactics.
And just because they're removed from it doesn't make them any less guilty, just because it's not at the point of a gun, because people need to remember poverty is one of the most extreme weapons these people have. And it has probably killed more people on the planet over time than anything has. And it's something that could be fixed very easily. You know, just because they don't have the right green paper doesn't mean they should all starve to death. But when you add those deaths to the list, yeah, it's ridiculous how many they're responsible for. And in terms of the Bush family, it makes 9/11 just seem like another day at the office, doesn't it?
No, it makes Adolf Hitler look like a schoolboy.
Man.
I'm not kidding. I am not kidding. We're talking numbers that are unreal. And when
right.
we talk about Hitler, one of the main funders for Adolf Hitler was Prescott Bush, George Bush Sr.'s father.
Mm-hmm.
Which not everybody is aware of. It was not him personally that took all his money going to Adolf Hitler, but he was the one funneling the money into the Nazi war machine. You know, there were two other key players, Alan Dulles and John Foster Dulles. They were brothers. They were lawyers, and American lawyers working together with Adolf Hitler and IG Farben, the giant chemical. German giant you can almost equal IG Farben and the Nazi war machine. These two go together. So when you see who was funding it, you will see who was behind it.
Mm-hmm.
And these people afterwards, when the war came to an end, because this elite has funded both sides in both world wars, incredible, but when you look into it, it's absolutely true. And they do that on a regular basis. They fund both sides to keep the conflict going.
Right.
They thrive on death and destruction. That is their game. So the longer they can get it going, the better, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Then after the Second World War, when the world thought, oh, thank God we got rid of the Nazi threat. No, I'm sorry you did not, because what you did, you had a small group of patsies that went to Nuremberg, the trial in Nuremberg. Most of them low-key generals. They had absolutely no idea really about the major agenda. And the rest, they had killed them and put them in jail and so on, these 12 ones, or they committed suicide. And then a major part of the rest ones, of these hardened Nazis, were imported into the States and South America through Operation Paperclip.
Mm-hmm.
Who was funding, who was organizing the whole thing? Alan Dulles. Okay, he was a major part of Operation Paperclip, and that was through the rat lines of the Vatican. We will get back to the Vatican, the city of London, that's the financial center. The Vatican is the so-called religious center, and the war center is Washington, D.C. These are the three places they play ball in between, you know, so
mm-hmm.
they just... Anyway, so Alan Dulles and then helped all these Nazis. And the Nazis, they got into America, for instance. You had people like Reinhard Gehlen and many of these awful, awful Mengele and Klaus Barbier and people like that imported. And they were part of building up the OSS at that time that later turned into the CIA.
Mm-hmm.
Here we are, where one of the first directors was Alan Dulles. You know,
surprise, surprise, and
surprise, surprise. He was also deeply involved in the JFK assassination and later member in the Warren Commission that was investigating the assassination. No wonder that we never found out what actually happened officially. And they were also part of this totally starting the whole NASA thing with the rocket, Wernher von Braun and all of these people. So and they're deeply involved in so many different areas in modern society. And these companies that were behind the German war machine, BSF and IG Farben and so, the only thing they did was they changed name of the companies. They're still around, still same agenda, and they're still just pushing forward.
Mm-hmm. Man, and it is so frustrating, man, that There are people who still stand up and applaud these guys if they walk into a room. You know, there's people around this country here who still have their pictures on the mantle. You know, they're saluting these people. It is so damn frustrating. But to switch gears a little bit here, we know that a lot of these suspicious deaths of high profile people have been carried out by this group. We talked a little bit about the assassination of JFK and Robert Kennedy. And I wanted to go a little deeper and focus on a lot of these rock stars, because a lot of them have been victims of this group. And the deaths I've heard you talk about, I think Jimi Hendrix would be probably the oldest of this branch of the conspiracy. I mean, he was killed in 1970, and by this time, this group has already killed Marilyn Monroe, JFK, Robert Kennedy, Malcolm X, and Martin Luther King in that order. But this was the first time Operation 40 dipped its tentacles into the assassination of musicians, isn't it?
No, absolutely not. They were doing it way before that. But let's start with Jimmy, because he's one of the most well-known. Mm-hmm. When it comes to Jimmy, I have not been able to find out who killed him. I can only say that one of the things in the mid-60s, it's very important to remember that it was only then that the racial thing in the States was so powerful. You know, black and white, blacks were still treated very, very badly, like an apartheid thing. And anyone who supported that the races should mix and become like a unity was fiercely fighted by people like J. Edgar Hoover and the FBI and so on. They did everything to stop the thing. And King, Martin Luther King, was one of these people, Malcolm X as well, that stood up and said, come on, you know, we're brothers and sisters, treat us the same. That's the only thing we want. You know, we're not asking for things that is absurd. Just we're human beings, brothers and sisters, and that's it. And so mm-hmm. they targeted, it was a lot more, of course, behind that as well, because they were standing up against the whole war machine and all of these things. Because one of the major parts in the U.S. Army are minorities. African-American and different Latinos and from all different types of countries. You know, these are most of the gunfodder or white poor people. So they need them to be able to get the war going on, you know. Mm-hmm. And one of the things in the mid-60s was the Black Panther was gaining a lot of strength. But they were talking about a militant opposition against this white power elite. Mm-hmm. And so anyone who started sympathizing with the Black Panther automatically came under the amplifying glass of FBI and other people. And very often when they take out people internationally, it is very important to understand that these secret security forces and so on, like the CIA, the Mossad, the South American BOSS, the Swedish Säpo, and so on, MI6, they, on a lower level, they are separated. But once you get up into the top of the pyramid, they're all connected. This is why when you look into things like 9/11 and so on, when people say it was the CIA, no, it was the Mossad, no, it was the so. And the answer is yes, they were there, you know, and in many of these operations, there are members from these different organizations on site, carrying it out, working side by side. So that's an illusion that it's different because we think that they're so separate down here. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so one of the things that they do, if they have a problem in England, for instance, they send over people from the States. And if they have a problem in the States, they send over people from England. So, you know, it's the same with the chemtrail pilots. They don't get them to spray their own country most of the time. You get foreign pilots, they do it. It's easier to do it on people you don't sympathize with in the same way and so on. So it's a standard thing. Mm-hmm. And with Jimmy, one of the things that got him into a major mess was that he was the first African-American, the first black musician that really made it into the rock scene. He was the one that opened the door. Mm-hmm. And he went to England, and it was like a bomb exploding there. He became incredibly popular. And At the same time, he was targeted by ProIntel and other organizations through the FBI that was really trying to shut him down or stop him. But also other things were behind this. There was a lot of problems. He had a lot of problems with his manager, Mike Jeffrey, who was involved in very strange things, also including the mob and so on. As far as I know, the mob also being something that the CIA and the MI5 normally uses, MI6, depending on what they need and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And so when he started supporting the Black Panther, I think that was when he really signed his own death warrant. And the way he died, we're all being told that he took an overdose. He was in a hotel room, took an overdose, and he died of his own vomit. I think that is the standard the story that most people have heard. But when you look at the evidence, I always prefer coming to a crime scene as what I call Farmer Brown logic. You know, one plus one equals two.
Right.
It does not matter if you have a massive long title and a medal and a white coat or whatever, or you can show things on 3D animation, the truth is still the truth. And one plus one equals two. If you try to fool me into tricking to believing that it's 34, I know there's a reason why you're trying to trick that into me into believing that. And if I follow these lies, they will in the end get me and point me in the direction of the real truth. So these lies can be very useful.
Right.
But when it comes to Jimi Hendrix, he was he had just started seeing a German girlfriend called Monica Dannemann. And she was with him the last days of his life. And they came to his hotel room one night. And in the night, they say that Monica wanted to go and buy smokes. And then there are different stories on what actually happened. But according to her, she came back and found him unconscious. And she called the ambulance, said, please, please, you need to come, you need to come. The ambulance came. They got hold of him, got him into the vehicle. She followed and they got to the hospital where he was dead on arrival. But when you speak to the ambulance driver and the other guy, which they have been interviewed, they say she was not there. They were called, they arrived. They had no idea this was Jimi Hendrix. That was somebody they didn't even know who he was. They just saw this black man apparently dead already.
Hmm.
And what they did was she was not there. She did not come in the ambulance either. And they picked him up, took him to hospital. And what the doctors noticed was that as soon as they touched him, there was red wine coming out of his mouth and his nose, meaning that his lungs were totally filled up with red wine. And they checked the alcohol level in his blood, absolutely nothing, very, very low. And there was no overdose of heroin or anything like that. He didn't use heroin. He was more into LSD and these type of... So as far as I know, he never used smack. But what the doctor said was that he had died from drowning. He drowned in red wine. And the only way you can do that is if somebody holds you down and just pump you up, you know, fill you up with red wine, hold you still so you can't... And so you start breathing in this wine and that, then it fills up your lungs and you drown.
Wow.
And this is how he died.
Man.
And his manager, Mike Jeffrey, who had been conning him for a lot of money, and there's a lot of weird things around this Mike Jeffrey. He, very shady guy. He later in 73, he died in a mid-air collision over France.
Huh.
When you look around these assassination or deaths on a high level, people have a very high tendency to die very young. I think around the JFK assassination, I have a list of about 300 people who died in strange ways or very young or car accidents or suicided or stabbed themselves from behind or, you know, these type of things.
And also, I was just going to point out Jimi Hendrix, he was 27, and that's a big thing people talk about in terms of these rock stars is people dying at 27. Hendrix, Janis Joplin, Jim Morrison, and it's like, is that an eerie coincidence or is it something more ritualistic? Because we know how much these people love their numerology and symbolism.
I'm not sure. I think maybe it was a coincidence to start with, and then when the numbers started adding on with Amy Winewood and so on, that maybe they did that in for a ritualistic thing at that point. I've spoken to assassins who have done these things, and the man I'm talking about, what he said was that he was never instructed about a specific date. That's not true. He said that very rarely were they given a specific date. He said that normally what was the thing was that they were giving the name of the target or the details around that, and then take him out, you know, and then it was up to the team how to do it and how to carry it out. Because he said it's so difficult to be stressed for time, you know, because the victim can just do unexpected things and suddenly take a left when he was supposed to take a right, and these things messes it up. And if you have a time limit, then you do make mistakes. So he said normally that is not his experience.
Interesting. But, wow. But, you've talked firsthand to one of these assassins?
I'm a so-called friend of a man called Chip Tatum. He was a deep cover CIA agent for 25 years, a black op assassin. He was one of the pilots in the Iran-Contras. He was a black Night Stalker pilot, Night Stalker helicopter pilot. He was, you know, one of these black ones. And he was also the commander of an ultra-secret team of assassins called Pegasus that was directly under the order of George Bush Sr. And he was part of 17 different operations globally, taking people out, you know, eliminating people.
Oh, my God.
He's now become a whistleblower and very, very brave man. I'm confused when it comes to Chip, because there's no way I can accept what he has done earlier in his life. At the same time, I deeply respect him for the courage that he's showing up now, you know, with the bravery. Mm-hmm. He's exposing the things he's been part of and how he's trying to, I would say, almost redeem himself by trying to do everything he can to help the world now.
Wow. What a fascinating life. So, yeah, I guess if we're going to stick with this theme of rock stars, you got Jimi Hendrix in 1970. I guess the next one. Oh.
Can I just say Monica Daneman?
Absolutely.
You know, the girlfriend. She kept changing the story of what happened. And at the same time, she made almost like a career. She was a painter, and she painted a lot of paintings around Jimmy. And she almost made a career out of having been his girlfriend. Then in, I think it was 1996, there was a court case with another girlfriend with Jimmy, and she lost it, and she was very, very upset. And then 2 days later, she was found dead in a car, in a garage, you know, where she had, what do you call it? There was a hose going in and committed suicide.
Yeah, exhaust.
Exhausting, yeah. But the thing is, with when it comes to witnesses, or people that want to step forward or become whistleblowers or something, one of the things that the elite fear are when people get emotional, you know, because then they start talking, or, you know, they drink too much and they start exposing things they're not supposed to say and talk about and so on. And I would say I would put a very big question mark around her suicide, especially since it was right after this court case and she was very, very upset. And I think maybe they feared that, my God, she's going to go open with it, you know, to get revenge on this other woman.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Man, definitely interesting that he died, his manager died, and this girlfriend who was there at the scene also died, all seemingly not at their own hands.
There's so many of them. So, so many. But let's go on to the next one. Which one?
Right, right. Yeah, if we're sticking with the rock theme and we were to go chronologically, it seems like if Jimi Hendrix was in 1970, the next one would be John Lennon in 1980. Although there's a big gap there. I mean, what were they doing in the 70s? That's 10 years in between those two deaths. Any big connections between there?
Yeah. I tell you, maybe I can come on another show and we can go into this, because there's so much going on during these years. Incredibly much going on. But when it came to John Lennon, you named a lot of people in the beginning of the program, absolute beautiful people. And the thing that they were standing up for was peace. This is the big problem for this military-industrial complex.
Right.
They want war. They want destruction. They want to keep this awful, awful thing going, because for some reason that is not only what they make absolute billions on, but also what makes them tick. Or I do not understand the mentality, but that's the whole thing. And when somebody stands up, especially someone that people listens to, you know, somebody like John Lennon or Lady Di or Bob Marley or something, mm-hmm. they become a major threat to this group, and that is why they've been taken out, I would say. And if we go back to Operation 40, like I said, there were many exiled Cubans in this. There was a few other ones. There was one of them was called Porter Goss. He later became the chief of the CIA under George Bush Jr. I mean, that is quite a career step upwards.
Right.
He was fired because of it. There was things from his past that was exploding in his face and so on. But when John Lennon was taken out, he had the FBI had been trying to get rid of him for years and years and discredit him, and he was under all types of surveillance and so on. And then he took a step backwards and spent quite a few years with raising his son and so together with Yoko Ono. And but then it came to a point in 79 where he decided, no, I'm going to make a comeback. And he just recorded this his comeback album together with Yoko Ono. And they had planned a big peace tour in America. I think it was even called the Big Peace Tour. And they were planning to do it in Europe as well. So here we are, a man that is an icon for peace. You know, these songs give peace a chance, or all of these things, where people in the millions would listen.
Mm-hmm.
And so on the night when it happened, there was this guy, Mark Chapman, who, as far as I've been able to find out, also had connections with the Bush family, personal connections, that he was connected to one of the sons. Anyway, Mark Chapman officially had been standing from the early morning outside the Dakota building in New York, where he was wanting to get an autograph or say hello to John and so on. And when the limo arrived in the evening, Mark Chapman, this is the official story, was standing to the right of the limo, and Yoko Ono left the car first and then followed by John Lennon. They walked in, there was about 5-6 meters in between them. Yoko Ono entered the building and John followed. And then boom, 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 a series of shots were fired. John went down. He started crawling into the building. Yoko came out screaming. The doorman ran over, grabbed the gun from Chapman, and they called the police and the ambulance. So the ambulance came, picked up John, and took him to the hospital where he was pronounced dead. Official story.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now you look at the crime scene. Mark Chapman was standing to the right. John Lennon walked by him, past him, and these shots were fired. So, of course, he was shot from the back and to the right. Absolutely not. All shots fired hit him straight from the left, and some of them were so close together that it was hard for the coroner to see if it was one or more shots, you know. Very, very small area of the shots that entered the body. So a good question would be to ask, do you want to ask the question? Was standing to the left.
Right, yeah, who was it?
Because if Mark Chapman was not an acrobat or Spider-Man, there must have been someone there. And at this evening, there's like a little doorway going in there. And this evening, there was a doorman, a nice elderly gentleman, glasses, good-looking, thin hair, and very kind smile and so on, that was working there. He was the guy that ran over officially and grabbed the gun from Chapman and so on. Chapman, by the way, after he fired the shots, he was just standing like a zombie waiting to be taken, which is a very, very common way of appearing when you're MK Ultra, mm-hmm. when these people are being controlled. You know, they're often used as the patsy, not to carry out the shooting itself, because they're not trusted to do that, but just to take the fall for it. So he was standing there like a zombie. This man to the left, his name was Jose Perdomo. And he disappeared into history right away. I heard his name just mentioned within the first few minutes after the murder. And then he was mentioned a few times as the doorman. Then he disappeared forever, you know. He's not even mentioned in the history books. Until several years later, Jose Perdomo, for 10 years, he was one of the highest ranking CIA officers of Operation 40.
Huh. Convenient.
Now you go figure how big are the chances of this guy, just by coincidence, being in the exact position where the shots were fired from, being one of the absolute top assassins in the history of the US. Well, in my book, it's a clear case.
Yeah. Oh, right. Yeah, I would say definitely. And that seems like a pretty common thing to do with the Patsies, is mess up their heads with drugs and mind control and get them in that place. And then, yeah, have the trained assassin make the kill shot and just leave them standing there with the gun. The other weird connection is that book, Catcher in the Rye. Both Sirhan Sirhan, who you mentioned earlier, and Chapman had that book on them at the time, as if that was some type of trigger or something to keep them busy. Who knows?
No, but both of them has been mind controlled. Both of them are showing the exact symptoms of what happened, you know, or what had been carried out. Like, very commonly, they have absolutely no idea of the event itself. They remember like an hour or so before the things happened, and then it just goes black, and then they wake up sort of like after the shooting. But when they start talking about the event, it is always without any kind of emotion, and often you can almost hear like a tape recording. It's the same wording, the same words being used again and again and again. Mm-hmm. Listen to interviews with Chapman. It's like, press play and listen to it, okay? We interview him again, press play, boom, and it comes again.
Right. And we see this in a number of false flags, too. I mean, some of these school shootings or the Aurora Batman Theater shooting, these guys seem just as surprised as anyone that they slaughtered a whole crowd of people sometimes.
But they did not.
Right, right.
They are patsies. And I tell you, sometimes you have to check into the background of these patsies as well, because I think it was, I'm not really sure, I can't remember which mass shootings it were, but there were two of these mass shootings where the fall guy, these two were the sons of two people that was investigating the disappearance of millions of dollars, billions, a secret computer system that the elite had set up to get money out of the country into secret bank accounts. And these two fathers were tracking and were in the process of exposing what was going on. And then boom, boom, these two mass shootings, and both their sons were framed and had to take the fall. And that totally stopped the fathers as well, totally discredited them from all future things to do, you know.
Yeah.
So sometimes there's more than one side to it.
Yeah, man. Really, really dark stuff. And we're getting kind of towards the end of the show here. I usually like to try to leave with something positive when we can. I mean, and when I just think of...
No, but this is positive, because the thing is that people think the whole world is crazy. The whole world is filled with terrorists, the whole with madness and violence everywhere. I tell you, the people behind so many of these atrocities, so much of this violence, so much of all of this awful thing with gun, with drugs and weapons and killings and murders and terrorists are the same small little group. It's
right.
Like, so it's super positive, you know. We have a small little group instead of the whole world being mad. We have a small little group that are just totally messing the whole thing up for us. It's like a neighborhood, and there's a one bully that is terrorizing the whole thing. So
right.
we just have to expose what is going on, you know, put the spotlight spot on them, find out the methods. I very often go into great detail exposing what methods they use in these false flag operations, because these mass shootings and so on are not real events, many of them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these are inside jobs there to scare us into accepting more and more control, more and more militarized police, more and more surveillance, all of these, and press us, push us into this very dark future that they want for us. But I see the future as absolutely brilliant, absolutely stunning. This is an amazing time to be alive, because now is when it's being exposed. Now is the time when we can take the world to the next level, you know, and create this world that it's supposed to be, you know. Watch, yeah. Look at nature. It's absolute beauty and harmony, and everything in harmony with each other, and balance and so on. We just need to get back in balance. But first, we need to stop this. That's the man. Stop the madness. You know, stop the madness.
Right. Yeah. Those are great points. I mean, when you factor in all the awful things these people have done, we have a relatively peaceful world. It's just a shame that we haven't done anything about it in 5-6 decades. It's like, when are we going to? But hopefully that time is coming.
The thing is, we've been asleep. It's by design. We have been duped into this, you know, over the generations. And so no wonder. Do you know, like, I saw this in the 60s. They had every night the TV ended with the national anthem being sung. I don't know if you've seen
that. I knew about that. Yeah, like, weird.
The stars and no, but the flag is there and the whole thing like that. And the whole nation salutes the flag more or less. And then you have the text of the national anthem, you know, blah, 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 and you can see the text go letter by letter, very fast across the screen, just like on an airport when they change the words, you know,
yeah,
like this. But if you slow it down, in slow motion, I'm sure you can find this on YouTube now. If you slow it down, you will see that just before each and every letter changes, there's another letter, because your subconscious is so fast, you know, that this is what they use in commercials and so on. Your mind is so much faster than you are, your subconscious. So when you start writing down the letters that are just before the real letter comes forward, what does it say? Instead of the national anthem, the songs, We Are the Free, or whatever it is you sing, it says, never criticize the government. Buy, consume, obey. The government is God. These things are there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And just being brainwashing people without knowing it. And do you know the name, what the meaning of government is? It means governmente, mind control. Control mind, actually. Control mind.
It's right there. Man.
It's right there, right in front of you.
Wow. You really know your stuff, man. And this has been a super fascinating show. Thanks so much for being here. I've learned a lot. I'm sure the people listening have as well. But before we really let you go, would you like to tell them a little bit about your website and the other stuff you have out there so they can keep up on your work?
For sure. It's like I said, I put 30 years into this, and I'm just an ordinary guy, family to feed, extremely appreciative of any support. It's financial support that I really need. Anyway, my website is lightonconspiracies.com. My book, one of them is Coup d'etat in slow motion. There's another that's about the assassination of the Swedish prime minister, but with all the links into the Iran-Contras, into the illegal arms trading globally, into the JFK assassination, and with all the links and so on. I tell you, it's 1,100 pages. Not because I like to write, but because it's so intricate, you know,
yeah,
and so intertangled. And so the only way to show it is by many pages. I'm sorry.
Right.
And the last 200 pages are membership list of the Bilderberg Group from 1954 and onwards. This used to be an ultra secret group, one of the parts, major parts of the world's shadow government. But I got all the members, the locations that have been secret, the agenda that has been leaked out, and so on. I was also invited as a key speaker outside the Bilderberg meeting in Copenhagen this morning, year, just a few months ago. So
that's awesome.
And one thing, without boasting, polishing my ego, I truly believe that I managed to defuse a false flag massacre in Copenhagen that was planned to be carried out in connection with this Bilderberg meeting.
Wow.
That would have been aimed at the truth movement and would have just knocked the whole thing out, including a major, major risk of knocking the internet out, you know, because this is where all this information is being thrown.
Wow. Can you tell us how that was done real quick?
Real quick? I don't know if I can do it real quick, but I can tell you. The thing is that I spent so many years looking into false flag operations, so I know how they operate, what they look for to pull one of these things off. It's an old Roman tactic called problem, reaction, solution. Mm-hmm. They secretly create a problem to get a reaction from the public, and the reaction they want is an emotional reaction, and the one they're always looking for is like, oh my god, something needs to be done. And then the population turns towards me, who they do not know secretly created the problem, and then I will come forward with a solution. And that is always a solution that would never have been accepted had it not been for the problem. Mm-hmm. Do you see? It's an old Roman tactic, and this is the one they use for all these mass shootings, terror acts, and so on. I tell you, after all of these years, I'm not sure there is such a thing as a real terrorist, because mm-hmm. every single time I looked into it, it's these people involved, either their staged event or the people carrying it out are equipped, trained, or financed by the same people again and again and again and again. Doesn't matter if they're called Al-Qaeda or ISIS or Mujahideen or you name it, same power elite behind it. Unreal.
Huh. Well,
anyway.
Oh, go ahead.
Have you got time?
Yeah. It's not a strict time limit on the show as long as you got a couple minutes.
Now, the thing was that normally this group, what they were created in 1954, and the whole idea was that they have a steering committee of some 8 people. This is with roots in the Nazi roots and in the global elite, the whole New World Order. And what they wanted with this steering committee is invite key people from each and every single Western country, so that with just a handful of people from every country, they can control that country more or less, you know. Mm-hmm. And these key people are from the royal family, media, bankers, politicians, you name it, in every single area of importance. That is what communication, the legal system, judges, these are the people they're aiming for. So they've done that since 1954. It's 60 years this year. And they have one meeting every year in secrecy. They've been moving around all over the Western hemisphere for different hotels, different countries. And it's about between 125 and 140 members per year that are invited there from all different countries. So you have foreign ministers, when CIA and Google owners and people meeting like that, royalties and so on, uh-huh. in absolute secrecy, which is, I mean, we're talking treason when it comes to many of these people, you know. You are not allowed to do these things. And anyway, in 2013, they couldn't hide the existence of this group anymore. It was just too obvious that they actually existed. So then they suddenly changed tactics, and they went for, no, of course we exist. We're this very nice group of people, you know, that just meet for a biscuit and a nice cup of tea, having a discussion here and there. Why do you even question what's going on? The reason we question and why people like me have, you know, put so many years into exposing them is that when you compare the agenda from these secret meetings and then what happened in the world the year after, it's almost identical. So it's very easy, or it would be maybe an intelligent observation to maybe connect the two. If this is what was discussed and decided and then it happened in the world, and this was discussed and decided, and then it happened in the world, maybe they're connected, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And they have been behind so many of these things, wars, financial, the whole thing, the whole mayhem. Anyway, so in this year, I was invited by a group of people that was trying to expose what was going on. And the meeting was, the Bilderberg meeting was, it was expected to take place in Copenhagen at the Marriott Hotel in the central Copenhagen. And so when I was invited as one of the key speakers, it was me, Luke Rudovsky from We Are Change, Dan Dix from Canada, and the Danish 9/11 expert, Nils Harrit. We were the four people invited. So I was very proud, and I said I would love to. So I flew in there, and I was picked up at the airport the evening before the whole thing started. And so I asked, can you please take me just to the location so I can have a look, you know, just to see the whole setting of the thing? Because I thought it was very odd that it was in right in central Copenhagen. Normally they try to be in a secluded area, you know, where they can have control of all parameters, you know, air roads in and out, that they can keep people at a great distance and hopefully that nobody would even notice what's going on. And normally, then when the members arrive, they come in black limos with tinted windows. I mean, just like in a James Bond movie, like vroom, vroom, vroom. And these are people like David Rockefeller, Bill Gates, you name it, all of these. Kissinger is a standard one, Queen mm-hmm. Beatrix, Queen Sophia. There's so many of them. Like I say in my book, Coup d'etat in Slow Motion, the last 200 pages are just the membership list and the locations and so on. So I was expecting the normal type of security that they have at these places, that, you know, bomb sniffing dogs, maybe snipers on the roofs, a very strong feeling of police presence and so on. We came to the hotel and there was absolute zero. I thought, my God, it can't be the right hotel. I mean, there was absolutely no people at all. But there were two Danish police officers standing next to the hotel, but more or less picking their nose, talking to each other, absolutely nothing that seemed like security thing. But then out, just in front of the entrance, there were three black limos with tinted windows, super polished and just standing there, identical. So since this is their trademark, it was almost like them putting a business card in the window saying, yes, we are here. You know? So I thought, okay. I thought it was a bit odd, you know, because there was no police, no security, no nothing. And I saw people from InfoWars. They were all the way up, you know, filming in through the windows. They were all the way up against the, you know, the windows and watching in and so on, which normally, like, these are sealed off areas. You can't get anywhere nearby and so on. So anyway, I started walking around. At the same time when I was walking around, they started building like a concrete wall around the whole hotel with like a 1 meter high concrete blocks. And then on top, like a fence with cloth so that you couldn't see in. But right in front of the entrance, it was open. So you couldn't see the cars arrive. But when they stopped right in front of the entrance, you would be able to get a super clear view of whoever got in and out of the car. Security wise, absolute no, very strange. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I was walking around and it just did not make any sense at all. So if you look from above, you have, there's a major water canal going into the harbor of Copenhagen. Then on the brink of this canal, that's the hotel. Then you have one of the main streets, two lane in each direction, on the other side of the hotel where the entrance is. Then on the other side of the hotel, there's a big open area. I think there must have been a big building there before that they took down with controlled demolition or something like that. It's a parking area now for the police, because right on the opposite side of this parking area is the Danish police headquarters, massive big building. And then on the two sides, other sides of this big parking area, there were high buildings, but as far as I could see, insurance companies and banks. So I was walking around and I just felt there's something very strange here, because when you look at it from a security point of view, these people have the best military advisors and security advisors. So why on earth pick this hotel? You know, especially if they feared anything, like terrorists, as they claim exist.
Right.
So, because on the water side of the hotel, you have water is very hard to protect, you know, because you can have divers, you can have submarines, you can have whatever. And on the other side of the canal, there were so many buildings where every single rooftop or window would be a possible threat, you know, Stinger missile, bazooka, you name it, these type of things. Also, the entrance so close to one of the main streets where they did not close off the traffic, meaning that every car that would pass could be a possible threat. You know, machine gun out of the window, hand grenade, you name it. It's just very close to the main road. So I was just very confused and walking around there thinking, if this place sucks for security, it must be perfect from another point of view. Why did they choose this one? So with my experience of seeing how they think when it comes to these things, I thought option one, a decoy. They could get, because the whole parking area was fenced in, and it was fenced in a way so the only way you could get into it was through back streets, a few back streets. And these back streets were going very close to the main train station and bus station in Copenhagen. So for the police, it would be a very perfect way to get the whole truth movement from that would arrive internationally. Especially on trains and whatever, from the airport and so on, they would also go there to control them from getting from that point into the fenced-in area right in front of the hotel. So from a police point of view, perfect place. Get them in a corral where you can have them under surveillance. And then you could send in a few doubles into the hotel, you know, put a mask on, make him look like Henry Kissinger, make up, you know, put a ugly wig on Queen Beatrix, things like that. Because we were like maybe 60 meters from the entrance, so it's very easy to if you only see a person for a few seconds, I mean, you can't see is this somebody with makeup on or is it the real person, you know, very easy. So that would be option one, that the hotel would be used as a decoy, and then the elite or the Bilderberg group would meet in a different location, maybe a castle, another hotel, maybe in a different country, maybe on a submarine or an army base, you know. But to keep the whole truth movement in one place where they were under control. But I was walking around, I thought, it's perfect for someone else. I couldn't really put my finger on it. And then, boom, it hit me. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Because if you look upon it the way they would do it, if they had planned a false flag operation, the way that they could do it and demonize the whole truth movement was to get the whole truth movement in the fenced-in area, controlled by Danish police that would not be aware of it. I mean, normal police officer would not be aware of what's going down. The top of the police, yes, because they're involved. So get the whole truth movement in there. The buildings on the sides, the banks and the insurance companies were to a major point controlled by members of the elite through the ownerships and so on. And the police headquarters, where the top of the police were controlled through the Bilderberg group as well, suddenly you have an area where you are in total control of everything. You know? The water, the hotel, the street, then you have the fenced-in parking area, and then the headquarters, the police headquarters, and on the sides, insurance companies and banks, buildings that you control. So suddenly you are in total control of that area. So what could you do with that? Well, one thing that they love to do is what you could do is send in a few doubles, make up in with a few doubles, but the rest of the building would be totally filled with explosives aimed in direction towards across the street and on top of the whole truth movement. what you would do then is you would place different I'm talking from their point of view. Place different film crews in the different buildings so you get all the different angles covered. You would have one film crew down this one of the street with a wide angle so that you would cover both the side and entrance of the hotel and the truth movement on the other side of the hotel. So you would get perfect images of everything, and you would get a helicopter, a so-called press helicopter, to film the whole thing from above. Then what you would do is you'd have secondary explosives dug in the gravel area, you know, very easy to do a few days before, so that you would have secondary explosives underneath the crowd.
Right.
You would have smoke bombs, you would have canisters with fake blood and so on. Because the thing is that what they're looking for is the emotional impact, you know.
Right, the trauma. It's
like, you know, you can't get a traumatic experience from a poetic film. You know, you need action, you need dead bodies, you need explosion.
Right.
Look at Hollywood. We're talking Hollywood again. You know, what do you need to get the whole thing going, to make an impact? Just watch a Steven Seagal movie or Die Hard or something like that. That's what they're looking for. Smoke, bombs, dead bodies, blood,
yeah,
all of these things.
That could have been the situation.
And a bad guy, a patsy, somebody to blame it for. Okay, so whole building filled with explosive. If it follows the template, also there would be something wrong with this building, you know, like 9/11 and other buildings, maybe a crack in the foundation, maybe fungus, maybe asbestos, something like that, that would make this building expensive to repair and therefore better to blow up. And in that case, you would also see that the insurance policy would have been changed a week or so before this event, just to include terror acts. Yeah.
Right, right.
That is
that's a huge giveaway when that happens.
We're talking insiders again. I'm just describing the tactics that they normally use. Okay, so to get the whole thing going, I would send in a group of infiltrators, provocateurs, into what they would hope for would be like maybe 1,000, 2,000 people in the truth movement in there, because you need a crowd, you know. You can't get a riot going if there's 14 people and a dead cow, you know. You need to get the whole thing moving. So getting a team of provocateurs, they would start screaming foul language, throw a Molotov cocktail, you know, maybe start a fight in the crowd, something like that, to stir it up. And at the same time, I would send in a second team of provocateurs dressed in Danish police uniforms, grabbing somebody right in front of the fenced-in area. The people that grab would also be provocateurs, but dressed like truthers. And then they would drag these people in front of the fence, speeding them up a bit. You know, they would be screaming and so on. So the whole crowd would go wild, like, let him go, this type of thing. And the whole motion would be on its way. Then once the commotion was there, boom, the whole front of the building blown up on top of the truth movement, secondary explosives going off at the same time. So suddenly you would have smoke, dead bodies, blood, awful, awful images that would then be pumped out in media straight away, saying, oh my God, here we are. This truth movement, they're talking about creating a beautiful new future. They're talking about being peaceful. They have Gandhi, yeah, and Martin Luther King as their idol. And look what they've done. They massacred this poor little innocent elite group that was just having a meeting, having a muffin and you know, a cup of coffee.
Mm-hmm.
Look at them. Look at them. We need to stop this awful truth movement. We need to stop it. I mean, look at the terrorism it has created. So we need to shut down a big part of the internet, because that is where the information is being spread, this dangerous, dangerous information.
Mm-hmm.
We need to ban all rights to demonstrate. We need to ban all rights to gather in big groups and so on. And in one go, they could just knock out the whole truth movement in
right.
a way like that, spreading this whole thing out.
That would be awful if that happened, but I guess... if that was the plan at the Bilderberg meeting, you know, how do you think that you might have thrown a wrench into that?
Because what happened when I saw that, I just thought, oh my God, either I'm totally paranoid here, or I'm actually seeing something that could be meant to take place. So what I did was I went home to a friend of mine and I called Chip Tatum. Do you remember I mentioned Chip Tatum before?
Yeah, the whistleblower.
The whistleblower. He has been taking part of false flag operations as well.
Right.
Black op assassin, very, very high up in the CIA, and commander of George Bush's private team of assassins, you know, not a beginner, not an amateur. I called him. I said, listen, Chip, I've got a really eerie feeling about this whole thing. Excuse me. And he said, so please describe the situation. I did in great detail. He said, so how is the coverage from behind? Are there any military vessels in the waters, any divers? And I said, there's zero, absolute nothing. He asked me about different angles, different things. I explained it exactly like that. When I was finished, he said, listen, this smells a long way. I think you are right. Get out of there and be very aware of strange, I don't know why he said that, but strange sounds, strange people, packages that could be of explosives, you know, parking meters strangely positioned and so mm-hmm. on. And anyway, so after I spoke to him, I phoned up Professor Jim Fetzer, who is a professor that has spent his whole adult life trying to expose 9/11, JFK.
Yeah.
Sandy Hook, all of these things. He also is a former Marine. So I spoke to him and he said, my God, it sounds like you're onto something there. Then I spoke to another guy that I phoned up. He's been in security forces and security services for 24 years. He asked similar questions. I answered and he said, my God, I think you're onto something. So after I had it confirmed by these three heavyweight people, I thought, okay, I need to do something. So what I did is I called up radio stations in Australia, New Zealand, Canada, several in the States and in Europe. And I just said, please record the time and date that this information is coming out. This is what I fear that they're planning. If it should go down, please, for the sake of God, please understand that this is not the deed of the truth moment, but an inside job trying to demonize them. But even it was what I also hope was that not only to expose that, but also to defuse it by getting the information out there. And these radio hosts were just amazing. I tell you, within half an hour, they were just pumping it out globally. So I did that until 4 o'clock in the morning and had a few hours sleep. Then the next morning when I came there, there was hardly any people. I think I scared everyone away. But
wow.
Anyway, but do you know what I found when I came there? On the area, in the area where the truth movement was supposed to meet in a few hours, they had built a massive big pentagram, a 6-meter big pentagram of train sleepers. Can you imagine the
wow.
impact? The impact of an like blown up bodies, smoke, blood, and in the middle of the truth movement, a pentagram the size of that, if you have an aerial photo, and that image would be spread out globally. Could you imagine the impact it would have had?
Yeah, that would have been the false flag of the century.
And as soon as I saw it, I got a friend of mine. We just right away, we went over there and we just pulled the whole thing apart. Well, nothing happened. I'm not sure if it was meant to be. I think there's a big chance that this could actually have been planned. And one of the things I want to mention is that the next day, there were very few limos arriving, very few people inside the hotel. But the people that were in there had name tags, exactly the same type of name tags around their neck as in Sandy Hook, as in many of these mass shootings. Have you seen those?
Mm-hmm.
And the Boston bombing as well. All of the ones I saw had these. So I think they could have been the ones placed in the hotel, you know, to get credibility, to blow up a handful. These people would be doubles, but it would only also be bodyguards, drivers, cleaners, these type of, and maybe a few old Bilderbergers just to get credibility, somebody that they were pissed off with anyway.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Man.
But what I would like to say is to the listeners, when it comes to false flag operations, one of the major parts is a drill. They have a drill with the same scenario as the real thing.
Yep.
And it starts as a drill, and then halfway suddenly it goes live. And many of the people who are in the drill doesn't even understand that it has gone live. Sometimes they're put in position as patsies without knowing it, or or if you hear that in your hometown or anywhere nearby, there's a drill for school shootings, mass shootings, terror drills, whatever the drill is,
look out. There.
No, not look out. Go there, start filming them. You know, when they start setting this thing up, it will look more or less when they set up like a film set. Film them, make it very obvious that they are being observed. You know, film it, stream it directly on YouTube. The more, the better. You know, go right. down a whole bunch of you with your cameras. Just film them, stream it, and then hopefully defuse it, you know.
Well said, because, yeah.
Because not only can it defuse it, but also if something awful should go down, then filmage like that could be incredible evidence to compare before and after a thing like that.
Absolutely.
So I think instead, up until now, it's always been that this awful thing happens and then we study the details. I would say, let's stop them, you know?
Yeah.
Not totally non-violent, but by exposing them, put the spotlight right on them saying, we see you. If you pull that trigger, we know what you're up to. We knew before you did it, you know?
Yeah.
That would make a major problem for them.
That is, yeah, that's great advice. Man, and to think that you might have stopped something like that at Bilderberg, I mean, the implications could have been just ridiculous, terrible for everybody. We might not even be able to have this conversation now over Skype if something like that had happened and this portion of the internet had been shut down. It would end all kinds of shows like this. But, man.
I think alternative media would have taken a big beating, you know.
Absolutely.
Think.
So. Well, man, it has been fascinating talking with you. A lot of great information about Operation 40, a lot of these deaths, the situation at the Bilderberg meeting last year. Man, we've been all over the place, but it has been a real honor and a pleasure, sir. Keep doing what you're doing, you know. Be careful out
Thank
there, man.
So I'm going to the Open Mind Conference in Denmark here in a week and so on. But it was the Bilderberg meeting this year. It was just a few months ago. Once again, if somebody says, I don't know what to do, I don't know what difference can I do, you can make a difference, a big difference, by supporting people like myself. Every single one that I know of these people you see on YouTube, people that devote their life to exposing them, we are all in a very difficult financial situation. I don't know anyone
Amen.
Who's not on his knee. So if you let your money go to a good place if you don't know what to do otherwise.
But if you're here,
I would also say, otherwise than that, if you think you're powerless, I say you are not, because you can make a massive difference in your neighborhood, among the people around you, you know. Become an example, do good, be good, lift people, because this is such a dark time for many people, you know, such a sad and desperate time for many people. So you can make a massive difference. And the thing with this elite is that they control us by pushing us down all the time, to get us down and low in energy. You know, the lowest
Right.
of energies is what is called fear. And the highest of energy is what is called love in this universe.
Well said.
And when you study in a laboratory, when there's two types of frequencies, a high and a low, if you let them meet, what happens is it's not that they start struggling in the middle and start fighting. Suddenly, when they meet, the lower one just gets annulled, boom, like this.
Mm-hmm.
Just like when you switch the light on in a dark room, it's not the shadows don't fight the light. It's not like they're screaming, we're not leaving, we're not leaving. They just disappear. And it's the same with all of these situations. If you can keep your spirit and your frequency high, and this is the best thing of doing that, is filling your heart with gratitude for everything you have. Fill your heart with love and gratitude. You can always find things to be grateful for.
Well
the higher you are frequency, the harder it is for them to control you. So you're actually so-called fighting the elite by being super positive, by being super loving, by being super helpful, by being a fantastic human being. You know, look at these people who have sacrificed their life and follow the way they did. You know, we are billions of people now. It is, there's this incredible awakening going on. So you're not alone anymore. Or, I mean, I used to be extremely alone for so many years, and now there are millions of people, you know, so it's an amazing time. Yeah. And now, very soon I will shut up, but I would very much like to finish with a little prayer, if I may.
Sure.
I'm not a religious person, but this prayer I love, and it goes like this. May the entire universe be filled with peace and joy, love and light. May everyone, and especially the ones who heard us, be filled with peace and joy, love and light. Victory to that light.
Amen. Right on, amen, man.
And now I will be quiet.
Hey, I mean, we've gone about a half hour over time, but it doesn't really matter. You know, there's no strict time limit to these things. We're not on CNN where you get shuffled off before the credits. But hey, man, it has been a great time talking with you. Awesome information. I think everybody learned a lot. It's been a real pleasure. Keep doing what you do and be careful out there. All right, man?
Will do. Will do. And Greg, anytime you or anyone else want me back on, just let me know. I'm always here.
Sounds good, man. We'll talk soon.
Talk soon.
All right. Have a good one.
Hasta la vista, baby.
There we have it, folks. Operation 40. I hope you liked that one. I know I knew very little about Jimi Hendrix or Bob Marley's deaths, and I feel a little bit more enlightened now, so hallelujah. We also heard from this month's Money Bomb winner. Thanks for all the donations. They have dropped off quite a bit, but that's because now a lot of people are just signing up for the Money Bomb when they sign up for the Plus show, so it's a predetermined $5 rather than all the random $25, $50, and $100, and a couple of those crazy $1,000 donations I had gotten. Now they're mainly just $5, and it takes a lot of $5 to add up to something, but you don't got to tell me that. So either sign up for THC Plus or thank someone who does, because that is what makes it all possible. Also, did you folks see the update to the Georgia Guidestones? There was a small carved out notch there, apparently, and just this past week the notch was filled with a stone engraved with 2014. Spooky stuff. Not sure what it means, but I can't imagine it's any good. The world seems to be in treacherous waters these days, and it's hard to know if that's an illusion put out by media propaganda and perception management, or if we really are on the brink of several different disasters. Ebola, the Russian standoff, the sinking of the dollar, the powder keg that is the Middle East, the militarization of police. I mean, fuck, these things just keep ramping up a notch while we just sit and watch it. But maybe we need more people doing nothing rather than less. Let's take that approach today. Everybody's telling you to do something. Go to work, renew your registration, sign up for Obamacare, do the ice bucket thing, read this petition, don't eat gluten, don't drink so much, sign up for THC Plus. I mean, enough already. I like something that came up in today's show, really in regard to the military. Don't sign up. It doesn't matter if you see combat or not. Don't take the bribe to be part of that war machine. Just stay home. Don't be a contractor that makes millions of plastic FEMA coffins. Don't be the cops that stand off against your neighborhood. Don't read the news that you know is a lie. Screw that teleprompter. Just do nothing. Don't be the pharmaceutical rep. Just knock it off. It sounds funny, but so many of us are marching in line with this very machine, supporting it either with our dollars or our time and effort or our career. And Ole is right. There's not very many of them. They literally need regular folks to help them carry out their plans against other regular folks. So just stop. If you're participating in any capacity, just go home and smoke a bowl and start playing Destiny, for Christ's sake. And you could all make the world a much better place. And that's the message you won't hear anywhere else today. Do less. It's not going to fix the world, but maybe we'll just try to quit breaking it first. Don't bother getting any of my shirts from conspiracies.net. Don't sign up for THC Plus. Don't friend me on Facebook or Twitter. And for God's sake, stop listening. You're all God's special little snowflakes, so go melt into the couch and next week we'll change the world, right? Here's a song by one of the listeners who sent a ditty into the email for that stuff, podcastmusicarchive@gmail.com. This is Don Paul Moore with Old Friend, and I've done my part. That is it for me. Your move, Operation 40 Operatives. Your fucking move.
Some say we're on the verge of a great awakening. Others claim the powerful Puppet Master's multifaceted stranglehold is stronger than ever. And on the Higher Side Chats, we explore the conspiracies, the mysterious, the alternative, and the occult on a quest that rests firmly on the fringe, which won't be sponsored by Audible or Stamps.com, nor picked up by the gatekeepers of conventional media or radio. It's a quest of the people. So if you enjoyed this first free hour of THC, consider sponsoring the journey yourself by subscribing at thehiresidechatsplus.com. Just $5 a month gets you a second hour with all our great guests on each of our month's five shows. You can also make your own topic and guest suggestions right on your THC Plus profile, communicate with Greg Carlwood, and have your own custom RSS feed URL to use and still listen on the majority of popular podcast applications. You can also support the show with a donation into the THC Money Bomb, where on the last show of every month, we give half of the total donations back to one of the random listeners like you, who could use a nice surprise in these troubled times. And lastly, to support THC in a free and equally important way, share the show with your friends, review us where you can, and join us in the conversation on Facebook, Twitter, and our subreddit forum, where THC fans and the cerebral adventurers of the counterculture have taken refuge, and discuss the finer points of our never-ending struggle to tip the scales in favor of truth, peace, and enlightenment in a war-torn, corrupt, and shady world. Let the games begin.